Hi everyone and welcome to a new video about control system topics. And in this video we will look at the deadbeat response design. We will look at the concept, what is a deadbeat response in general. We will see and discuss a numerical value, and we will also verify our calculations using the simulation in MATLAB. So let's look at the situation in more detail. So there is a control system, and the goal of your control system is that you have a fast response. That's one of the goals, and that you have minimal overshoot. So the overshoot is also one of the important aspects, and that you have a zero steady state error. So the output will track the input. That is actually what is meant by zero steady state error for step input. If you have a deadbeat response, that will provide these elements. So you can have a zero steady state error if you design according to deadbeat response. You can have a very fast response, which will mean actually that you have a minimum rise time and also a minimum settling time. These two will define actually your response speed. Now the overshoot lies between 0.1% and 2%, which is actually very nice. And you might have an undershoot that is possible, and that is lower than 2%. Now if I of course want to achieve these nice characteristics, I must assume that there is an input which is a step input. If you have a ramp input, a parabolic input, this will not be the case. So remember that. Now, if you look at the graph here on the right side, this is a general step response where you see an undershoot. So the characteristics what we have discussed here in general are shown here. And we have also an overshoot. And there's also a final value here, which is approximately in this case one. So let's assume that this is a unit step response. So the final value and also the input amplitude will of course determine your steady state error. And this is only valid again for step input signals. And how fast this will settle or will be in some specific allowed region will also determine your settling time. And also how fast this will approach is determined by your, given by your rise time. One of the important notes for deadbeat response is that it is not applicable and useful for system with a delay. So deadbeat design is only useful for a system without a delay. So if you have a delay, of course, for example, you have a delay of 1 second, 1 second, so just the delay, but your time constant of your system is maybe 10 seconds or maybe 20 seconds. And the delay is actually very small compared to the time constant of your original system. Actual system has a time constant of 10 seconds. Your delay is maybe 1 second. But if it is comparable, for example, your delay is seven seconds and your time constant is 10 seconds, that is a little bit comparable. And this system and this design, that bit design will not be applicable for that case. So let's look at the deadbeat response in more detail. How can we analyze this? We will use normalized standard transfer function. And we will then compare the coefficients to have an optimal deadbeat response. It will be clear shortly when we see the transfer functions. For example, if you have a third order system, which is now given here as a standard form, which shears there is a s to the power 3, and there is a coefficient alpha, beta, and we have also the natural radiance frequency, so omega n. And this is a third order polynomial in the denominator, and we have omega n squared, cubed in the numerator. What we do is we will normalize this by dividing all the terms of the numerator and denominator by omega n cubed. That is actually what we do. And if you carry out that action here, you will have actually the following. So I have put now omega n to the power 3 in this expression. You will have the following situation. Now, if I now simplify this, I will have the following expression. What you see is the alpha and beta are shown here. There is a 1 here. There is also 1 in the numerator. Now, if I make a parameter setting, I set x is equal to s over omega n, then this transfer function will be, of course, much more readable, and that is given here. So that is actually our normalized transfer function for a third order system. If you have a fifth order system or a fourth order system, of course, you will have more terms, but the situation is discussed in a similar form. So if you have a higher order system, that will be also done in a similar form. And this is, again, the normalized third order transfer function. So for higher order systems, use the same method to derive the normalized transfer function. And the coefficients A, alpha, beta, or gamma, or any other parameter will be, again, determined by the similar form. And it will be used, the normalized transfer function will be used, and then will be assigned to the values for the coefficient will be seen in the dead beat response table. So if I now look at the coefficients and the response measures, which is actually shown in the table, what you see is the order, system order is shown here on the left column. So the second order, the third order, fourth order, fifth and sixth order. You have an alpha and a beta for, in this case, for the third order system. But you have a fourth order, you have also alpha, beta and gamma. And it will increase in the delta and an epsilon. So you can have five coefficients if you have a sixth order system. What you see is, for example, if you have a settling time criterion, you can look at in this column and compare the normalized situation and then determine the values of your alpha and beta just looking at the table. We will look at this in more detail when we carry out our numerical calculations. So the coefficients are selected to achieve a dead beat response and minimize setting time and rise time. Now we will calculate the omega n based on the desired settling time or rise time. So that's actually what we do is we have a requirement for settling time or rise time. So this is actually the response speed that's actually given as a criterion. And then we will calculate the required omega n for that. Now, once omega n is determined, then we can, of course, develop our complete closed-loop transfer function. And then we can move on with our analysis. For example, if you have a third-order system, it requires a settling time of 1.2 seconds. That is what you have. Now, then you have to look actually in this row. How can we carry out then this problem? Now, from a table of the normalized settling time, you will see omega n times ts, which is actually the normalized expression, is 4.04. So it is this seconds, the settling time here is are normalized. So you have to actually multiply this by omega n. So omega n times the settling time, which you actually should have, is 4.04. Now, if you want a TS, which is a settling time of 1.2 seconds, then you just divide the, or you work out this omega n by doing 4.04 divided by the TS, which is required. And then you have an omega n, which will be used later on, of 3.37 radians per second. Now, let's look at an example. For example, we have a third order system again, but in this particular form, we have now more data, it's more more detail. We have a plant, GP, which is given as 1 over S times S plus 2, S plus 1. So it is actually a second order system with a pole at origin and a pole at minus 1. It is a stable system in this form. Now, to meet certain specifications, we select the lead compensator, and which is actually given here as the transfer function. It's a general transfer function. We have a K of C, we have a Z of C, and we have a P of C. Where the K of C is the controller gain, Z is actually the controller zero, and the P of C is the controller pole. We also use the preamplifier or P filter of the form G of F, which is given by Z of C divided by S plus Z of C. And where the preamplifier pole, which is shown here, is exactly equal to the zero of the compensator, lead compensator. So we have just selected that as a condition here. So if you now look at the complete system, which is now configured as shown on the right side. So we have a pre-filter, we have an input, and then the pre-filter or the preamplifier, and then you have the summation, and that will, of course, first reach the controller and then your plant, and it will be in the unity gain feedback configuration. Now, this is, again, in a very general form, and also this one, only what you know actually is the controller, I mean the plant. So you only know the plant, you don't know much about anything else at the moment. So how can we design this using a dead-beat response is the following. We would like to have a design of a dead-beat response having a settling time of 2 seconds. So that's actually the only information we are now here given. So let's look at the situation. How can we tackle this? The solution is actually determine first the transfer function of your closed loop system. So TS, that's actually the first step. So TS is using the Mason's gain rule, as you can see here. I can say for this part, the forward part, just multiply the forward part, GC times GP, divide by 1 plus the loop gain, which is actually shown here. And that times the pre-filter, GF, is actually your transfer function, total transfer function. Okay, now, if I now substitute the values for the controller, for the pre-filter, and for the plant, I have this. As you can see, this is not really that readable, so we can simplify this a little bit. And you have then the following expression. Of course, I want the denominator expression in a polynomial form. So if I now make that also possible, after some simplification, I have now this expression in a third order form, which is nice. I can now compare this to the parameters of my dead-beat response table. Now, if I now look at the table, which is again shown here, I have now a third order system. That means actually I'm again looking in this part. So for the third order system, I look at this region. Now I need a alpha of 1.9 shown here, and I need a beta of 2.2, which is actually shown here. So alpha 1.9 and beta is 2.2. I also see that there is a setting time criterion here, 2 for 2 seconds. That means actually again 4.04 seconds as normalized setting time. It means actually the omega n times TS must be 4.04. That means that for setting time of 2 seconds, I have now in this case, omega n is 4.04 divided by TS, which is 4.04 divided by 2. It will be in this case 2.02 radians per second. So omega n in this case is 2.02. That will be used later on in our analysis. So the characteristic equation of the general third order system, the transfer function shown here on the right side, is the denominator equated to zero. So if you equate the denominator of this expression to zero, you'll have your general third order polynomial characteristic equation. Now, using the omega n is 2.02 and the coefficient for this third order system, alpha is 1.9 and the beta is 2.2, we get the following. So if I just substitute the values for alpha, beta, and omega n, I get this. Now, if you work this out, simplify this, you will get the following expression. That is actually the third order polynomial. Now, if I look at my transfer function of my system of this example, I have the following expression. And if I now equate the denominator equal to zero, that means the characteristic equation of the closed loop is then given by this expression. This is now the characteristic equation. Now, the next step is compare the characteristic equations. So we have a characteristic equation of the system based on the alpha, beta, and also the omega. And we have now determined from a table. And I have a characteristic equation based on my system. And this is shown here. So if I now compare this characteristic equation given in the red box and the in blue box, I can see that the like terms are as follows. This is 3.84, which is 1 plus PC, which is shown here. This is 8.98, which is PC plus K of C, which is just look at the terms for S. And 8.24, which is just KC times ZC. So this is actually what you do in this analysis. Now, if you work out this, just solve these equations step by step, we will start with this one. 1 plus PC is 3.84, and that will result in PC is equal to 2.84. Okay. If I now continue with the analysis, I can now just continue with this one because I already calculated PC, then the KC will be 6.14. And the next step is calculating the Z of C. Now, you can do Kc times z of c is 8.24. And if you now divide out the Kc we have determined here, you will get 1.34. Now, we have now determined the required elements for our transfer function of the controller and also actually for the p-filter. So, that will now, the transfer function for the controller and also for the p-filter will be as shown here. Just substitute the values. Actually, you have now the transfer function for the controller and also for the p-filter. Now, the closed-loop transfer function, the total, is then given by this expression. Just substitute the values in here. And that is actually what this system is in total form. Now, let's look at the simulation result of this example. I've prepared the step response using MATLAB here in this slide. As you can see, this is the unit step response. What you see is the final value, let me start with that one, is just one. So I have applied a unit step input and my output reaches a final value of one. That means I have a zero steady state error, which is exactly what we have anticipated using the deadbeat response. I see a settling time of 2.01 seconds, which is very close to 2 seconds. So it is already very nice. The overshoot is, in this case, 1.6% approximately, and there is a rise time of 1.2 seconds. Now, if I look at it again at the table, shown here, here we have for the third order system, an overshoot of 1.65% max. I'm very close to that one, so it is nice to see that there is a comparable overshoot. The undershoot might be 1.36%, but that is of course the max value, so you can also have also zero, so there is no undershoot in our case. So that will confirm also that our specification actually is met, very close to 2 seconds. The final value is one, so that there is no steady state error, and overshoot is actually very close to what we actually see also in the table. Now we will also see this in a simulation in the real time, so I will also now jump to the MATLAB, where you can see what happens if, for example, we change some parameters. So let's now look at the MATLAB simulation. So we are now at our simulation and we have now opened the MATLAB. What I have done is I have also generated application of control system designer that will be useful later on in our analysis of the controller game. And I'm now first typing in my parameters for the loss parameter. So let me do that first. So TF is the loss parameter. So we have now defined the loss parameter. Let me first do the open system. So GP is equal to 1 over S times S plus 1, which is actually the transfer function we had for our plant. Now, the parameters for the controller K of C was 6.14. The zero was at 1.34. And the pole was at 2.84. That's actually what we had. So I have now the required elements for our controller. The controller is then G of C is then given by KC times the 0, which is S plus ZC, CC, divided by S plus PC. This is the controller. Now, this is actually what we have. We have now also the pre-filter, which is Z of C divided by S plus Z of C. Now, I can check, of course, my GP, just looking at the ZP key form. That's actually what we had. If I now also check the controller, it's exactly what we had. We have the gain here, we have a zero, and we have the pole. And if I also do the filter, pre-filter, which is now also shown here. Again, we have the zero, and we have the pole. So it is all nice here. If I now want T, which is now the total transfer function, is now, first we do pre-filter, which is G of F, times the feedback, and the comment, the first entry is the forward transfer functions multiplied. So that's actually the controller times the plant. And I have a unity gain feedback, which is one, and I have negative feedback, which is minus one. That last entry is not really necessary, but it is always handy to put it there. So I have the following. If I now write this also down in the pole, zero pole gain configuration, then you can see the following. What you see, what you recognize, it is not really in the minimum realization, because this is the zero, it will cancel this pole actually. So if I do this, t is equal to min real, and then t, I will have a simplified form, which will of course now cancel this zero and this pole. I have now this expression. Okay, this is actually what we now have. We can see that there is a real pole and there is a two complex conjugate poles. So we have for sure a underdamped system. I will now check the step response of this one. We will now check the setting time, also the steady state error, etc. Using this. So I can now import here using this architecture. And I have actually this configuration. So configure a different configuration, but this is actually what we have. So for F pre-filter, we have now said that this was GF. So you can type in GF. The controller that was in our case G of C. Our plant is G of P. And there is a unity gain feedback, so this will be just one. So if I now do OK, you can see there is a running. And we have now generated the plot. Now we have here a step response. Let me put the grid. If we had a pole and the zero, so we have this root locus plot, and this is for the body plot. Let me remove the body plot. This is not really necessary at the moment, so I will just get rid of this. And we will see the root locus and the plot of our step response. It's actually unit step response. So if I now look at the characteristic, for example, the peak value, it will show us the overshoot and the peak time. We will also look at the settling time, which is one of the requirements. As you can see, it is 2.01 seconds. And if I also look at the steady state value, the final value, which is here one, that means actually there is zero steady state error. Now, the location of the open loop poles are shown here. So this is the open loop pole here, there's an open loop pole there. So it's zero, it is a minus one, which is actually the two poles of our plant. We have also a pole, of course, at this, which is at minus 2.84, which is the pole due to the controller. There's also zero of the controller, which is at minus 1.34, which is actually this one, this circle. Now, this is actually the plot or root locus plot of our system. If I want, of course, if I select another gain for a controller, if I make this 6.9 or maybe 7 or lower, the location of the poles will change. So if I take my hand here and I will just move with the pink closed loop poles here, we have three closed loop poles, I can change my controller gain. So in this case, I have now a settling time of a little bit larger than 2 seconds. For example, if I want to improve this and make it closer to 2 seconds, I can try to get the poles at the right location. So if I do that, so I'm now moving, and you can see directly what will happen with your step response. So at actually somewhere here, it was very nice. So it was approximately 1.92 or 93. So it is now a little bit better than the setting time what we had before. And this overshoot is also smaller. So it is now approximately 0.8. And it was before this 1.56 or 57%. Of course, if I make it very aggressive all the way there, I have maybe a setting time which is not really the required value. If I go down, make it like this, I have now a setting time which also larger, and also I have a overshoot which is also much, much larger. So if I do this, and again come back by just fine tuning and try to find this value. Now, this is now the setting time, which is in this case what we can do at best. If I now want to also determine now the situation, the controller gain for this case, what I do is I go here, you do export, and you select the C, which is the controller. So you do export. And I have now the C. If I now go to the command window again, I type here C, I get the expression for the controller. As you can see, this is the controller what we now have. It is 7.04, which is larger than the controller we had earlier, which was 6.14 for the game. So the KC is now has now changed. So it is now not 6.14 anymore, but 7.04. So yeah, by changing the gain a little bit, so by fine-tuning only the gain, not the zero, not the pole of your controller, you have now made your system also has a much smaller step overshoot, and also the setting time is also much closer to the 2 seconds, even lower than 2 seconds. And it's actually one of the ways to fine-tune your system by looking at your simulation results. Okay, this is actually for this example, having discussed the deadbeat response in general form and also in the numeric example that you can show here. We will continue with similar examples, so keep in touch. If you have any questions, comments, let me know and I will try to answer them as soon as possible. And don't forget to like and share this video so that they can reach more people. Thanks again for your attention and see you next time and have a nice day.